Fair warning, we are starting the recording here.
So, welcome to tonight's presentation. If you're here, obviously you got the memo. Tonight we're going to talk about Tor Onion Services, and the working title was, or how I stopped learning to, or how I learned to stop worrying about my IP address and learned to love the Tor. You guys clearly are all part of the mailing list, so yeah, I'll skip over that. But yeah, tonight I'll post these slides if you have any questions or thoughts or whatever. So with that said, now on to our featured presentation. And yes, that is from Dr. Strangelove.
Yes, that is. Right near the end.
So, brief review of the history of Tor. In the 90s, the Naval Research Lab came up with the idea of onion routing, and it was basically to let spies communicate without being spied on. They came up with the idea of an onion router, so you basically have your packages inside of another package, and it has layers like an onion. In 97, DARPA sort of expanded the idea, and in 2002 they released the alpha version of it. 2004 they sort of built on it a little bit more and improved it, and started a 501c3 foundation that was funded by the EFF and others. Well, that lasted for a while, pretty much from what they've been able to track back. The US government is now the primary funder of Tor for various reasons. Why? Well, officially, it's because there are people in disadvantaged places around the world that need to communicate freely and not be oppressed. So it's a real nice way to let them get access to that information and spies, journalists, human rights, etc. And people who just don't want to have to deal with their IP addresses. So what countries are using Tor the most? Based on the last numbers I was able to find in 2013, the US has a pretty big footprint. Europe had a impressive footprint as well. And it's interesting that some of the more oppressive countries also don't really have much technology. You can see some of the African countries where they do don't have necessarily the same amount of freedom, are a little bit less represented there. But Brazil was somewhat of a surprise as well. Yeah.
Where's North Korea?
It's like half
good Chinese spec.
Yeah, the resolution on this projector, I don't think is good enough to pull that off.
Because it's tiny.
So, of course, one of the big questions is, how exactly does Tor work? If you remember me talking about the onion, here you are is your computer sitting right here. You connect to one of the entry gateways in Tor, and then you get routed from node to node here until you finally hit an exit node and go off out into the internet. Now, of course, that's great because this guy right here has no idea that you're over here. He also doesn't know that you're going to over there, so you're well hidden. There are a couple problems, though, because this guy knows that you're right here. guy knows that you're going over to there, and say if you're not using a secured form of communication, like say HTTP, well, that guy can see everything you're doing, or he can man in the middle of you. Now, one of the even bigger problems is, say you're a large nation state actor, like US government, and you own more nodes than probably is healthy to own, and you both own this one and this one. Well, now you can sort of put two and two together and figure out what's going on. So, are you safe going and visiting websites on Tor? You're not that interesting, but there's a better way. What if instead of exiting out here and going out to the internet, you could just stay inside the network? Well, then this guy wouldn't know what you were doing, and neither would that guy, because it's secured and wrapped all the way through. Hence the idea of private services. So, as I was hinting at, what if you never had to leave Tor? So, this comes up the idea of onion services. And these are slides directly from Tor's website. So, in step one, Bob, the service that you want to connect to out on the internet, picks some introduction points and connects up to them. And sort of as part of the network, lets them know that, hey, I want to connect to these guys. I'll be welcome. So he announces out to the whole network that, hey, I have xyz.onion. And all of the nodes in Tor are kind of this meta database of these addresses, and so it knows that you can connect to him at these different introduction points. So if, like, say IP2 there dies, well, we don't care, we've got two other ones still. So Alice wants to connect to Bob, knows his onion address, and says, hey, I want to connect up, and sets up where to meet. And then Bob sends a message to everyone who's listening and says, hey, I want to talk to you. And then Bob connects up and meets up. And then Alice and Bob are talking together across the Tor network. Of course, one of the big problems is Alice is using three hops to get to her rendezvous point. Bob is using three hops to get to the same rendezvous point. So there is potential global latency going on. Say one of your hops is in, I don't know, Djibouti. Well, the speed of light alone means that it's going to take a while to get from point to point there. So there are downfalls to this. So, okay, this sounds like a lot of work. Who is actually using these things? There are a whole bunch of services out there. The Facebook is one of them.
Yeah. It's probably the most ironic of them in there a while.
Well, so why would the Facebook want to use this?
Because they can de-anonymize it.
No, it's because while you may not care that Facebook knows that you're posting your cat pictures. Say you live in a dog-loving country that has outlawed cats. Well, so you want to communicate with your friends and family who are also cat lovers without the man.
But doesn't everywhere that Facebook operates local government can get its stuff through subpoena?
Oh, but the local government doesn't know that you're connected because they don't know who you are.
Isn't the whole point of
the be anonymous?
and say you want to be communicating with your fellow revolutionaries who want to bring cats to the world, well, you saying, hey, we're going to have a cat protest in Dog Square, well, the government would want to know that. They won't necessarily know that if everyone's all operating via Tor. They don't know that the message ever went out.
Except it's the DNS connections.
Not if you're connecting to the Facebook core URL there. All of your traffic is...
Well, you know, once you...
They could just, they could just watch the Cat Lovers Facebook page.
Yes.
This is why I'm like, why? I mean, I get the new York Times.
Have you seen the picture?
I get proton mail. I don't get
that. Have you seen the picture with the sidewalk and the gate fence posts on either side? And the gate? And there's nothing on the other side? And there's a beaten path around both sides of it?
There's a driveway between my mom's house and my house. That. Although there is enough of a slope that most vehicles couldn't make it. My smart car's small enough if we weren't
so even if you directly tied it with an IP address, if the nodes facing outward are known, they know you're connecting to that.
So there are gateways that people have set up and share
to
make it so they know that you're not. You're not necessarily connecting to a Tor node.
Right.
Now, of course, it is a game of cat and mouse. I believe it's China has been fairly effective with the Great Firewall to prevent Tor connections.
Yeah. Now, how do these get banned emails? Did you cover that already?
I haven't, but to answer your question, brute force.
What?
They
just spun up a service until it matched?
They brute forced their way till they got, for example, NY Times 3. So the reason why there's a gibberish on the end there is they stopped brute forcing as soon as they got
the first part.
Enough of what they wanted.
This actually is somewhat of a problem in why Tor is moving to longer addresses.
I was going to say, I see that RiseUp is. That's a lot to type in.
Yes. So, I mean, there is a happy balance between there, but that's how they get vanity addresses, is just by pure brute forcing, generating addresses until they find one that works.
So you can't just, like, how does an address generate? Can I miss that?
We'll get to that here in the demo. But yeah, basically you just spin up a cluster on Amazon and start hashing.
And it's like Bitcoin.
Except for these are actually cool.
Exactly.
And don't waste as much energy.
So
you can do it on a pie.
So other more legitimate uses are like, say, the Guardian's if you want to talk to a journalist and give them secret information that you don't want your employer knowing about, Snowden.
See how that works for
him. You can post stuff there. Or if, say, you're in a authoritarian government where you want to read the New York Times and see what the rest of the world is seeing. Those are various different things. Proton Mail is another great service. There's chat engines that use.
Proton Mail free? I don't remember.
It's free.
The early stage is free. Okay. So it's like Gmail.
Far more restricted than Gmail size was.
Okay.
But yes, there is free access to it. So to sort of go into your demo. Question here.
Now, quick question that I forget. I used to know. When you spin up Tor and you start connecting through Tor, are you therefore also one of the relay nodes?
Only if you want to be, which it would be very nice if you would be willing to, because that's how the whole world goes round.
And I know the exit nodes are the thing you generally don't want to be unless you have a very good lawyer.
Yes. It is the opinion of the EFF that you don't have to worry about that. However, yes.
You do. You don't have to worry about it if you get them to pay for your lawyers when somebody sues you.
But if you're one of these guys in the middle here, you're perfectly fine because you don't know what this guy's going to, and you don't know where it's going. Because each hop is wrapped in the next hop's encryption. Kind of like an onion.
Almost like it'd be in the hand.
Yeah, so just the early setup steps here, since I didn't want to have to go through the trouble of resetting everything back up again. The first thing from a version of Ubuntu here you have to worry about is Tor actually recommends that you use their version of Tor versus Ubuntu's, because apparently the maintainers in the past haven't done a good job of keeping up with security concerns.
Ubuntu, not really.
So, the first thing they tell you you need to do is install app transport HTTPS in order to allow apt to connect to secure connections here. Then, of course, the next big thing is that you need to actually add their repo to your list. It's kind of hard to see there in the purple, but it's dev.torproject.org/torproject.org and Bionic, just because I'm using the most recent version here. And then you just do a, then the other big thing is that you have to install their GPG keys, or else apt totally freaks out. After you've done that, you do an update, you install their keyring, and then you can run the apt install Tor apt install Tor, and then also, since we're going to be demoing the OpenSSH server, we want to go ahead and install that too, because this is a just straight off the CD install. So of course, after it does all that stuff, hey, we're good to go. The next big thing here, and I'll flip over to the VM to show you directly, you want to edit the Tor C file. So, as soon as I log in, and just so I don't have to keep typing sudo, we're going to run bash as the super user. I mean, look, we're root. So just ignore those. So just ignore those up there. Those will come out here in just a minute. You'll scroll down to the point where it says this section is just for hidden services. And so what we want to do is name a directory that we haven't, that doesn't have anything in it yet. Hidden service is going to be the name of our service. and then you say, well, I want to take port 22, and it's a local host at 22. You can also name pipes, perfectly okay. And if you just do that without the hidden service authorized client itself, then anyone who knows your address that will be generated here in a second can connect up. The moment you put that it's in stealth mode, then only people who know the secret can actually connect. So after we've entered these lines here in, we go ahead and restart Tor.
What do you mean by the secret?
We'll get to it in just a minute here. So when it restarts, one of the things that happens here is, if you remember here, we had a directory, this var lib Tor hidden service. If we look there, now that it's running, there's actually a couple files there now. And so there's a client keys, private keys, and a host name. So the thing that we really care about, because we need to find out what is our address now, is this host name. So if we go, we have an address there. And this is that private key that I was talking about. So you can just type it in each time you want to log in to something. You know, that takes a lot of work. I'm lazy. So we can go ahead and just store the keys that we care about in our Tor C file again. So if we go back here to our Tor C, and look here at the top where I threw them in, there you can see our onion address and that secret. So this is the authorization to connect up. If we actually don't have that there, and we try and connect to my service, since I have that one flag there set, so we just change that and restart Tor just to be sure. And then we try and SSH into something here. Just about any command that you care about, you can actually wrap in a SOX 5 proxy by using Torify. And so that will go ahead and wrap your SSH request in a inside of the Tor connection here. So if we go ahead and take our onion address here, and we try and connect up to it. So let's go ahead and change the address that isn't working right now, and go ahead and paste. Remember, since we don't have that secret there, we're going to try connecting, and nothing's going to happen because our onion service will ignore us because it doesn't like us. So just we'll sit there for forever and always, and nothing will happen. So what we can do here now is if we go back into our Tor C file, copy and grab both the address and that secret. And go ahead and enter in, serve off, and the file from our address here. If you see it, it's the same exact one. So the great thing is when you switch networks and you move around, I'm on a different IP address than I was before. It doesn't matter. because I connected into the Tor network. I still have my private key, so I can verify, yes, I am still who I say I am. So my address hasn't changed, even though my IP address has. So we just go ahead and write this, and then we start, or just to be safe, drop back out of root, and now we can try connecting up here.
If you generate a new private key, that's where the brute forcing thing.
Yeah, so basically what happened is they just kept generating key after key after key until they found one that fit what they were looking for.
Okay, so
it's beautiful. Oh. I love it.
So it was siphoning with a goal.
Yeah, to get a vanity address.
So that's awesome.
The Facebook Tor address.
Imagine if domain names work that way. So you have to start hatching before you can acquire this domain.
So
is .onion, IANA, or whatever, recognized?
TLD?
Yes, it is.
Anyone else?
No, that's
but I'm guessing you can't buy them.
So, it is worth
it. Otherwise, it's just gibberish.
This is no route.
You can't specify.
Which is why it's amazing that Facebook
got it. There it goes.
It took a while for Tor to connect up. Since I've restarted Tor, it had to do all the
time. It's almost like you're going through like 3 or 4 hops.
Yeah. So now I
can. Isn't it once you're done?
SSH in here.
I thought the Tor network was always 3 hops.
By default, it's 3.
You really specify?
You might be able to. It's really not very beneficial to go through more hops.
Does the 3 include the entrance and exit?
Yes, I believe so.
You're really only 1, though. But doesn't know where you're at.
The problem that you run into is if everyone was using more hops, you're just really wasting network bandwidth. And Tor really doesn't have enough to go around. But so here you can see we've SSH'd into a machine. We don't know what the IP address is. And actually, it's behind a NAT because it's running in VirtualBox. So even if I did want to connect to it from out on the internet, I couldn't. But by knowing the Onion address, it works great. If the demo had worked right and my machine at home hadn't gone to sleep, I'd actually be able to connect in via that one just fine. But instead, we're just sort of looping back on localhost in the most inefficient way possible. But so here, if you look, I'm typing. There is a little.
Yes.
So. Leaky.
Oh my.
Hello. How are you? So, depending on the routes you're taking,
you're also in VirtualBox.
Yes, I mean, so I'm
a lot of layers.
I'm on VirtualBox. I'm SSHing to VirtualBox.
You're a DVAX public Wi-Fi.
It's like a shallot inside of an onion.
Yeah.
It's like a Tootsie Pop, only it's an onion around it.
But so the biggest benefits here are not only is my traffic wrapped by Tor's encryption via SSH, I know that I'm talking to the right machine because I have all of the keys and it's a known machine that I've connected to before. So this solves that bad actor problem where not only do they have to brute force the Tor network, they also have to brute force the fact that it's connected via SSH, ECDA, DSA encryption as well. So you have to brute force your way through an awful lot of encryption, so we're for the purposes of this, we're probably pretty safe.
And you'd have to reinforce it with second long latency for every character.
Yes. one of the things that have changed here in the last while is that HTTPS certificates for Onion services are now allowable as a secondary name on the certificate. So let's say New York Times certificate will also advertise the fact that it's the certificate for the Onion service as well.
Yeah.
Let's Encrypt, unfortunately, I don't think supports it.
But wouldn't that also be a potential exposure vulnerability? Because then a local, so for the people that want to get to New York Times that aren't supposed to be allowed to, they request HTTPS version of the Onion New York Times. Their local government can be watching for anything that contains the New York Times public key.
No, because all of the communication for that is flowing over the SOX proxy.
Oh, right, so it's already over Tor, so it wouldn't. Okay, that makes sense.
So, but in...
The vulnerability point is the entry node.
Yes. So the fact that it's a signed SSL certificate, yeah, they can't see the fact that you're connected up, and because of the fact that you're communicating to a Tor service, it's end-to-end encrypted, so that entry node to Tor doesn't even know who you're connecting to. It just knows that you're connecting onto the network.
That makes sense. Okay.
So that gets rid of that bad actor on the end node.
Nice.
Now, of course, if anyone remembers the old Silk Road or any of those other, or let's see, I think the other one that really was a big story when they got hacked was several of the child pornography sites. Just because you're connecting to a service via Onion doesn't mean that you're necessarily safe from that Onion service being hacked. It's a computer out on the internet somewhere, and so a bad actor, nation state, or anyone else who really wants to take down stuff, all they really have to do is also connect up and just happen to either through bad information security hygiene or just the fact that you didn't ever update your server and there's a vulnerability in PHP, well, now if they own the other machine on the other end, well, then they know who you are and that you're connected up. And the fact that you're paying with a credit card, well...
Why you're supposed to use the stolen credit card?
Yeah. Or they just happen to put a JavaScript app or something like that, pass it back
Flash.
To you.
I heard about Flash being a big thing.
Or the Flash vulnerabilities or whatever that then connects out over the regular internet and, well, then, hey, they know what your IP address is and can come down and kick down your door. Not that I'm advocating that you should do anything illegal with this, but then that's on you if you decide to go down that road. So that was the big demo I had here. As you can see, it's fairly simple. It's not hard to set up.
Remind the config file, you mentioned something about you could use a name pipe or a pipe or something
yes.
like that. What was, I didn't follow how that would be.
So rather than a port, you can also, in Linux, everything is a file.
Right.
So you can actually, give me a second here.
So if you wanted Tor to just pass data to something on your system rather than listening on, say, SSH? Or
yeah, so you could pull up
so I've used the people before, they can be pretty useful.
Yeah, so
let's see here, I remember it was on. Yeah, so you can use what port you want it to connect into, and then just say Unix colon and the path to whatever the socket name is, and then you aren't even worrying about connecting out onto the internet or onto the network virtual service stuff. So you can actually use the SSH pipe instead of, or if you want to run your own, write your own service or something like that.
I guess I'm not quite following how that's useful or how exactly it works. So somebody connects to you on port 80, and anything they send gets sent to a FIFO.
So it's a bi-directional port. So you're...
So you'd have to set up something listening that's also pointed to that pipe. Okay.
So you're reading and writing from that pipe to communicate using a Unix pipe instead of a IP address. So then you don't even have to expose your service to the network at all, because it's all traveling over pipes.
What services support it? Apache support it?
I'm not exactly sure offhand. Okay. I know SSH does.
Okay. So you can set up an SSH server that won't even listen on 127.0.0.1?
Yeah.
Oh, nice. Didn't know that.
So Apache.
That's something I'll be looking into.
It's
gonna make work on.
See if you can do it via.
Well, that's good.
Yeah. It could be more than
that. How many do you have in that VM? Not enough for 4 tabs in Firefox.
Apparently not nearly enough.
Well, he's got Chrome open too, that's why. Yeah. I don't know, since Quantum, I've had quite a bit.
So anyway, I'm not exactly sure all the services that support it, but.
Practice I can look into.
Yeah, it's...
I had to do that part.
I think this VM only has about 2 gigs of RAM dedicated to it, so it's on the light side for a full desktop.
That's the age.
Especially in 03.
Yes. But, so, anyway, though, this sort of gives you an idea of say you have a computer up at, say, a parent's house or something that's on a DHCP IP address that rotates, or it's behind carrier-grade NAT or whatever. It doesn't matter. You can still connect to it, even though it might be slightly painful.
Yeah, for that task, I'd probably just use auto SSH to connect back to me and then do the port forwarding.
Yeah, I mean, you could do the knocking to set it up, though, or something like that. It's a great way to not have to worry about how to connect into a spot that's in a maybe hostile network environment, like, say, the DNAP Wi-Fi. But, so anyway, though, even with the PowerPoint slides that I have here, I've documented the entire process of everything I just showed you guys by screenshot. The other thing that Tor does recommend is that if you are going to host a Onion service, that you don't be also a node in the network as well, because apparently it can not play nice with each other, just bandwidth-wise.
So
So it's not a security concern, it's a congestion issue, or routing
yeah,
concern.
Yeah, if Tor is busy doing other stuff, it might not have enough time for you, is my understanding of it. But so you can do all of your different modifications, or there's a lot of different other things that you can change your...
So you don't even have to set up a service to use Tor, you can use it as client only?
Yeah, you can be client only. And by default, that's what it is. But there you can see resetting Tor and looking at the... So this is, first of all, just setting up a hidden service without the privacy and hiddenness turned on. So then all you have to do is just, you get that address and you're good to go. And the moment you add in the hidden service, that's when you get that secret to include along. And then you add it in, and there we are connecting into the Docker instance that is currently sleeping. And then there's also some additional documentation there, as well as a YouTube presentation that goes on for well over an hour, wandering into the far nitty gritty of how onion services actually work. If you ever want to know anything about it, this guy talks way too much. But so that was what I had for presentation wise. Cool.
All right.
Of course, latency, your mileage will vary on latency is the only pain point, but with great security comes great latency.
Yeah, a lot of people use satellite internet. They can deal with it, I can deal with it.
Yeah.
For one-offs.
And I do know at least the Tor client for Android, you can, although it does decrease your amount of security, you can control where in the world your nodes are, your hops are at.
Nice.
So, like for example, if you want to visit KCCI's website, for some reason, certain countries in the world, they don't have licensing to show you their news stories. I don't actually understand why, but via Tor, because KCCI is a fairly easy one to remember and type in. I tried pulling it up just to see how well it worked, and it wouldn't actually show me anything because I wasn't in their target market. So by forcing it over to the U.S. market, then I was able to get there. But as an interesting aside, at least on Android, I know. Speaking of Facebook again, you can actually run a Tor connection on your phone, and
notifications still on. My bad.
Speak of Android,
this is the droid you're looking for.
So then you can actually also turn on Tor for the Facebook client, and all of your traffic will be going through the Tor network for your Facebook app.
Nice.
So when you visit China or wherever, you can still look at your cat pictures.
Very important thing to hear.
At least it walked in China.
So that's your mileage is better.
The fictional countries of dog is saying does not have cats.
Anyone ever wants to hear stories about PCCI last year? I don't get it. Interesting.
Right?
But we should probably turn off the video recording here before we go in interesting stories.
Yeah. Right?
But we can go ahead.
I did like the tablet fire setup.